Good afternoon, everyone!
Good afternoon.
Wow! Beautiful people of God! Magandang buhay!
Amen.
Yes?
Amen.
Are we all blessed?
Amen.
Yes! I have too many microphones, otherwise... Where can I put this? Okay, children of God, thank you! All right, we are still in the series of faith. But before I begin, let's ask God for His presence today. Okay, let's bow our head and pray and acknowledge that He's here. Heavenly Father, thank you that you are here. Thank you, Lord, that you promised two or three gathered together. You are in our midst. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father, for what you're going to do in our midst today. Father, decrease me that your spirit may increase. Father God, in the name of Jesus, thank you for signs and wonders. I say thank you because I know that you had hear us. Father, in the name of Jesus, help me, Father, to explain your word. Father, you are the great teacher. And I thank you that you are here. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Father, bless your word today. Let your will be done. Let your kingdom come in our midst today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Yes, we welcome all the men again in the house. I believe that men should be spiritual leaders in every household. Stanley is smiling there. I believe that is what he's hoping for. Now, the message is faith. Well, we're still in the series of faith. The challenges of faith, that is the message today. Our key verse is at Hebrews 11, 8-10. By faith, Abraham, when he was called, obeyed to go out into the place which he was to receive for an inheritance. He went out, not knowing whether he went. By faith, he became a sojourner in the land of promise, as in the land that his own dwelling in tent with Isaac and Jacob, the heir with him of the same promise. For he looked for the city which had the foundation, whose builders and maker is God. Okay, let me give you a little background who Abraham is. Abraham is the father of many nations. Abraham also is known to be a friend of God. He is well known to have a very intimate relationship with God. He is, in fact, a friend of God, as I said. So if we want to know, to be known to be a friend of God, we must follow Abraham's example and trust enough to hand over him. Similarly, most precious to us, trust is essential. Probably measure of relationship is based on trust. The more you trust, the stronger the relationship will be. Isn't it? The more you trust, the stronger the relationship will be. Now, let me explain the contents of the text today. Now, here is a man who God asked to be relocated. God is asking him to go in another country, basically. So he went out without a map. And those days, I think there is no, you know, those tom-tom that you can put in a car, that they can tell you exactly where you're going, the street where you're going, or the road where you're going to be heading. Those things are not even known at that time. So here is a man that God wants him to go and look for. He had no reservation, he had no map. There's nothing there that will direct him where he's going. Well, what did he do? He go out there and went there. People may be thinking, his friend, he leave his friend behind. His, you know, all the things that he know in the place where he is, he left it behind. And This is a man, we're talking about a man of 100 years old, right? I mean, those friend of him was saying, what are you doing? This is absurd. Why are you going out in the land that is unknown? Why are you doing that? You're too old for this. I think that is his friend was trying to tell him. You know, sometimes our friends will discourage us to do something, especially when we know that we hear something from God. So this friend, so-called friend, is asking Abraham, at your age, you want to go in another country and you don't know where you're going. And when people ask him, his friend asked him, where are you going? And he said he doesn't know. But there is thing that he said he doesn't know where he's going, but he know whom he was going with. That's the difference. He know whom he is going with. And he know who is sending him to the unknown land. It is God. He obey God, and for that reason, he and his children get the land. The land that was promised to him, he get it. And another thing, you know that Abraham has a promise to God that he will have a child. He will have a son. He will have a son. I mean, imagine even gynecologists in the land will tell him, you cannot do this. You're 100 years old. Your wife is 90 years old. What are you doing? You're not fit to be a parent. How can you run around the street? I mean, I am a mother. When my son was little, as soon as they get up, they open the window, they want to go to the park. You think this man and woman of God, 100 years old, have those stamina to go in the park and run for the kids? Obviously not. Even Abraham was laughing to himself, that is at Genesis 17:17. Then Abraham fell upon his face and laughed and said in his heart, shall a child be born into him that is 100 years old? And shall Sarah then, a 90 years old, bear? See? But this is a promise to Abraham, isn't it? He was promised to have a child, that his age will not be an issue, because God promised. At 90 years old, she will bear a son, and they will call him Isaac. But during those promises, you know, women like me and you women out there, we're so impatient. You know what happened? Sarah get a better option. She said, oh, I'm going to give you our maid. Sleep with her. And there is an Ishmael. An Ishmael. That is because Sarah wanted that the promises of God to be quick. You see, sometimes when we don't wait, our plans can be a disaster. But then, yeah, let's go back to Abraham. Yes, he was promised a son. Yes, he loved what the Lord is saying. But in his heart, he never doubted God. He never doubted God. Because he knows that he who promised is faithful. Now here comes the challenges of our faith. When you say challenges, all of us will be challenged in our faith. After a certain time when God, you know, then Isaac was born. After a certain time, now God wants Isaac back. Right? That is at Genesis 22:7-1. God wants Abraham to go to the land of Moriah to sacrifice his son. Any human being would say, Lord, why are you doing this? I just have my son, and now you want him back. What's going on? But he didn't do that. Abraham never reasoned to God. He never reasoned to God. He said, you know, as I said, any human being will reason out and argue with God. Imagine he's a friend of God. Yes, a friend of God. Have a very intimate relationship with God. It's like you and me, if you are my son, you know, those relationships, you can argue, like Tony was saying earlier. He can argue with his wife, he can argue with his families, because they are families. But Abraham didn't do that. He knows that whatever God wants him to do, there is a reason for it. He trusted God and proved God that he loved God more than his son. More than his son, after all, my dear friend, without faith, it is impossible to please God. It's impossible to please God. You know, God is a jealous God. He's a jealous God. If anyone is taking your affection away from him, he will take that person out of your life, I believe. You know why? Because the first commandment is love your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your being. You have to put God first in anything. He wants all of you or nothing at all. That's why if you are a lukewarm Christian, God will spit you out. Do you know that? If you are a lukewarm Christian, God will spit you out. There's a difference in living by faith and a risk taker. Do you know that? That's a character difference. I don't think Abraham is a risk taker. I think he is a man living by faith. He's a man living by faith. In today's world, whatever you're willing to lose for the sake of God, you will keep it. But whatever you're not willing to lose, you will lose it. You will lose it. At Abraham's case, he proved it to God that God is more important than his son. He is more important than his son. Now, let's give you another example of another incredible man of faith. Noah, he's a righteous man. Blameless among the people of his time, he walked faithfully with God. God decided not to destroy the land because he was great and faithful man. You see there, my dear friend, for the sake of one righteous man, God relented to destroy the earth. Now, my question to you today, why do you think if one of us that is sitting here, we said we are righteous. Yes, we become the righteousness of God through Christ Jesus. But one thing that strikes me, not all people that go to church have Christ in their heart. You know that? Some of us, we go to church out of obligation. Some of us go to church because it's a routine. My question to you, is Christ really in your heart? That you're willing to give everything for him and look like this incredible man of God. Noah, yes, he's a righteous man. In fact, God relented to destroy the land because of his obedience and faithfulness. Believing what God is saying is true, even he had no proof. That is at Hebrews 11:7. By faith, Noah, being warned of God concerning things not to seen, as yet moved with godly fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, through which he condemned the world, become heir of the righteousness, which is according by faith. By faith, Noah built an ark to save his family. Noah's decision did not only benefit him and his family, it benefited the whole earth. Imagine, you know, Noah is 500 years old when he built the ark. He's 500 years old, even older than Abraham. He started preaching and building an ark at 500 years old. In today's world, believe me, people will say, well, I'm too old for this. Don't bother me now, Lord. I don't want to do this. I can't do it. But this incredible man of God, with no, they didn't argue, they just obey. They just obey. Obedience is better than sacrifice. People probably laughing at him, building a boat. You know how cruel people can be. Even your so-called friend will tell you, are you building a boat in the middle of nowhere? What are you doing? Have you lost your marbles? I'm sure those friends, so-called friends, is criticizing Noah. Why are you building this boat in the middle of nowhere? There's no rain. Are you losing your marbles? You're 500 years old. Do what you normally would do. Don't do this now. But you know what? Noah is right, and they're all wrong. They're all wrong. His act of faith, God used him to start the world all over again. What a calling. What an impact. Even, I certainly say, what a legacy. Wow, wow, wow. Do you know that God, once in his majestic power, regretted to create the earth? Do you know that? Because of those wickedness, he wished he never created the earth. But there is one righteous and faithful man that stands in our behalf, and that is Noah. God relented to destroy the earth because of one righteous man. Wow, wow, wow. You will probably ask me, why am I telling you all this story? All of us will endure weeping in the night like them. We will also have challenges in our faith. But one thing is for sure. Yeah, one thing is for sure. There is rainbow. There is rainbow in everything. You see, remember after the flood, God promised Noah the sign of a rainbow that he will never destroy the land with flood anymore. With flood anymore. If you belong to the redeemed household of God, the devil is after you personally. Enemies will attack you and your family. But fear not, the Bible said, he overcome the world, and we are more than a conqueror through him that love us. He will never withhold good things to those that walk with him uprightly. He will never also allow us to beg for bread. You know, Pastor Romy was saying the importance of our tithes and offering. Please don't argue with the scriptures. Just do it. You know why? Because it's for our own good. For our own good. The scriptures are the word of God. It is designed for us. This is designed for us so that we know how to live a righteous life. The eyes of the Lord are those are searching the whole earth in order to strengthen those hearts that are fully committed to him. Only God knows the heart of men. The reason I'm saying this is, yes, challenges of our faith comes to everyone. If we don't have challenge, life will be too easy. And when life is too easy, we forget God. Isn't it? We forget God. We think, well, Lord, I don't need you now. But if there's challenges in our lives, we call upon God. Why? Because he's the only one that can answer our problem. He's the only one that knows everything. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He changes not. And believe me, when you need God, you call Him, isn't it? That's why He never wanted us to be, He wanted us to know Him personally, intimately, like this man, incredible man of God, Abraham, Noah, all of these are people like you and me. The difference is they have greater faith than you and me. They have greater faith. They're not a risk taker. They are God. They fear God. And their faith is knowing that whatever happened, God is with them. God is with them. So whatever challenges you're going through in your walk with God, be still and know that He is God. In our trials, He'll never give us beyond we can bear. But He is faithful. He cannot, He cannot disown His children. Never. Never. He will never disown His children. He will give us strength to endure like a good army of God. So we put on the full armor of God. You see, when we don't pray, we're like, the soldier, the army of God should be well equipped in our prayer. Prayer changes things. If you don't pray, then you are what? You don't have, a weapon to defend us from the strike of the enemy. So we had to put on the full armor of God. That is at Ephesians 6:10-12. Finally, be strong in the Lord and His strength of His might. Put on the full armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our wrestling is not against flesh and blood, but against the principality, against the power, against the world, rulers of this darkness, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. See? You know that Satan is a traitor. He never fights face to face. He's a liar. He's a liar. He never fights face to face. But you know what? We had a great advocate. He stands before us in heavenly realm. He's seated at the right hand of the Father, interceding for you and me. Interceding for you and me. The good news is, every knee must bow, every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of the Father. There's no other name that is powerful than the name of Jesus. He's God that changes not. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. So whatever challenges of faith you might be going through today, trust God. Trust God. You know what? Because your soul is important to Him. Your soul is important to Him.